Hi, my name is Dr. Jeffrey Terrell. I'm an otolaryngologist or ear, nose, and throat surgeon at the University of Michigan. I specialize in rhinology and sinus disorders, that's nose and sinus disorders. Today I'd like to talk about hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia and nosebleeds. I work actually, obviously, at a large academic medical center. We see many patients with unusual disorders. If you're watching this, you know what hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia is, or you can read about it at the Cure HHT website. So that's www.curehht.org, I believe. And I'm going to talk about nosebleeds today. So many patients, if not most patients, with hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia will develop nosebleeds. Usually they start off quite mild, and as people get older, many of them get more frequent nosebleeds. And there are guidelines that are out on the Cure HHT website that doctors can access. There are some guidelines and lots of reading materials for patients as well. I'm going to talk a little bit about how I like to manage nosebleeds with patients with HHT. It has been an evolution in my 25-year career here at the University of Michigan. I've tried some of the older therapies that were the only therapies available 25 years ago, and there's some newer things now that I think are quite exciting in the management of HHT patients. Suffice it to say that the first thing that everybody should be doing is keeping their nose very moist. So patients with HHT that have nosebleeds should be, you know, basically running a humidifier if the air is dry. So that's the wintertime in Michigan. Anytime there's static electricity in the house, that means it's dry. I tell my patients, run a humidifier in the bedroom. If your nose is dry or crusted at all and you have HHT, you're going to get more nosebleeds. Many patients also then like to add some sort of oily nasal spray or nasal drop. I've used Pretz, P-R-E-T-Z, nasal spray. Ponaris is another one. Rose geranium oil is one that there have been some studies on. Some people use Aire, A-Y-R-E, nasal gel. Other people use Aquaphor with healing ointment just around the front part of the nose. Some people put Vaseline in the nose. Anything that's kind of oily will protect the nose from drying out. Saltwater sprays are helpful, but if you want to protect the lining of the nose and keep it moist, it's like dry skin. You wouldn't want to moisturize your skin by just putting water on it. You'd put some sort of oily lotion on it to keep the nose moist. This is very important in patients with HHT. After that, sometimes patients continue to get nosebleeds. And I sort of divide them into two different types of nosebleeds. There are the, you know, streaking teaspoon, maybe tablespoon nosebleeds that can occur once a day to three times a day. Patients may say, I can't bend over to tie my shoes because I get a nosebleed. But they tend to be, the first class is sort of these small nosebleeds. A teaspoon, two teaspoons, something like that. And in my practice, I have moved to something called injection sclerotherapy. And this is a drug called sodium tetradecyl thiosulfate. It's a mouthful. It's a very, very, very tiny needle. We inject the telangiectasias or small arteriovenous malformations in the nose. These are raised, thin-walled vessels. They're very easy to see with an endoscope. We look in the nose with a 4-millimeter glass endoscope. And you can see these raised, thin-walled vessels. They kind of stand off the surface, and they can be injected with this drug. It's actually a detergent. And I've seen even, you know, 3 or 4 days after surgery, the tissue just kind of dies, and thicker, more healthy mucosa grows over them. So I really appreciate the benefit of this for patients with teaspoon size nosebleeds, teaspoon, tablespoon. It works quite well. Sometimes there's 2 or 5 or 10 different raised lesions we need to treat, and sometimes it takes more than one treatment to get ahead of it. But I've had many patients that say, wow, you know, it helped me cut down dramatically for 6 months, 12 months, 18 months sometimes, depending on how bad their disease is. Now the second class of patients come in, and they say, I'm anemic, my hemoglobin's low, I'm on iron supplements, I can't get my blood counts up, and I bleed a half a cup at a time. I mean, really gushing, brisk nosebleeds coming once a week, as well as some smaller nosebleeds. And when a patient tells me it's half a cup to a cup at a time and it gushes, I typically prefer to take them to the operating room. And I use something now, and I've evolved to using something called Coblation. It uses cold ablation. It uses plasma. And so it's at a low temperature, say 40 to 70 degrees Celsius. Your body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. It's 40 to 70 degrees Celsius, and it basically ablates these arteriovenous malformations that bleed a cup, half a cup to a cup. And so there's a learning curve to that. Not many surgeons are using that. I have a separate YouTube video that I've put out about Coblation, that's C-O-B-L-A-T-I-O-N, for HHT. And I'm telling you, that takes care of the vast majority of my patients these days. I've done laser in the past, which I think is a tool, and many people use it for really small nosebleeds. But now, the really small nosebleeds I treat with injection sclerotherapy. So the laser is a tool. It's been used. Many people still use it. But I do those procedures in the office for the minor nosebleeds. If you have a major pulsing, high-flow arteriovenous malformation in the nose that could be a centimeter or centimeter and a half and raised and pulsatile, the problem with the laser is when you hit it with a laser, it'll eventually start bleeding, and then the laser is no longer useful. I've used suction cautery, which is electrical cautery, and there's patients that need that. I mean, cautery is just another tool to sort of to kill the AVM. There are patients that need cautery. It's a life-saving measure. And so I've done that in the past. I don't use it very much because the Coblation works better. People talk about a different type of cautery, which is silver nitrate cautery for little tiny nosebleeds. That can be done as well, and has been done for a long time. The problem with cautery with silver nitrate, if you cauterize the same spot on both sides of the septum, you can end up with a hole in the septum. And that can happen. Sometimes patients with hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia have a large pulsatile malformation right down the middle of the nose. And sometimes to treat the nosebleeds, which can be life-threatening or very severe, sometimes patients end up getting a septal perforation from some whatever treatment is necessary if the AVMs go right through the septum. It's almost impossible to avoid it. So those are some of the treatments that I've done. I have used some other therapies. I've used Avastin topically. It's a chemotherapy type drug that there's some data out on, but I don't think that's really proven yet to be helpful without a doubt. I think there's some more studies. I think there might be a role for it, but I find other treatments are more effective. I have used Avastin topically. I have used Avastin as an injection. Again, in unusual circumstances, I really use injection sclerotherapy and Coblation as the mainstay for the majority of patients. I never say never. I would never say that silver nitrate cautery is there's no role for it, because there can be pregnant women where you don't want to do anything with any type of injection or surgery sometimes. I would never say that cautery is, you can't use electrical cautery. There's a role for it. And there are some other procedures that I won't talk about today, including septodermoplasty, which I don't use anymore. I don't find a role for, but there may be some indications or cases where that's deemed necessary. And Young's procedure, where you close the nose off, actually sew the nose shut, is apparently quite successful as well. But you can't breathe through your nose, and you can't smell things as well also when after that surgery. So although that is done, and I'm sure is necessary in some cases, I fortunately haven't had very rare need to consider that surgery. So I hope that's helpful. Thanks for your time. If you haven't seen the video on Coblation, take a look at it. And for patients in the Michigan area that would like to be seen for hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia, I'd be happy to help coordinate your care. We have a website at the University of Michigan. If you search the University of Michigan and HHT, you'll find our website that can help facilitate a visit to the University of Michigan.